Anyone know what's my favorite video from Shoe on Head? It's the one where she defends centrism. I have to say that it's quite epic. I feel like there's a need to defend the viewpoint from both sides of the political spectrum, as it has come from both. This channel started back in 2016, a time when there was a surge in right-wing channels that went on unchallenged in most cases. Those were the first people to talk bad about moderacy on the political spectrum. But what about the left? How do they criticize centrism? Well, Vicky1999 supporters are a clear example. They simply call you a right-winger and say that you can only be a centrist if you primarily have left-wing reviews. Basically saying you're only right if you're a left-winger. And in the majority of cases, that is it. With that said, I would like to turn our attention to a like-minded YouTuber called Second Thought. He's one of those YouTubers that used to be good but got pretty radicalized. And he takes his own swing at moderates multiple times. But for starters, we'll focus on the first video on that topic, because here he inadvertently tells us a bit about himself. And I thought we'd analyze that stuff, as it would also explain why he's wrong. I haven't done this in a while, and I kind of miss it. That is why we can listen to liberals rant and fail the same way they did back in 2016.
You've read the title, you've seen the thumbnail, you've inspected the element and combed through the metadata. This episode is about moderates, centrists, independents, pragmatists, middle grounders, fence straddlers, and the ungodly, unceremonious, electable politician. Today, we're looking at everyone's political neighbors in the middle of the street. Let's get this started. Cue the MLK.
She fucking left me because of you, you fucking ass.
First, I must confess that over the past few years, I have been gravely disappointed with the white moderate. I have almost reached the regrettable conclusion that the Negro's great stumbling block in his stride toward freedom is not the white citizen's counselor or the Ku Klux Klanner, but the white moderate who is more devoted to order than to justice, who prefers a negative peace, which is the absence of tension, to a positive peace, which is the presence of justice.
Look, I already know what you're going to say. JT, please describe to me in political science terms what a moderate is. Fine. But only because I want to.
We all know that, so let's just move on. But you just have to listen to this first.
And as punishment for being so presumptuous, I'll start with the difference between the left and the right. You probably already know the story of the two terms. During the French Revolution, those who wanted to laisser les bons temps brûler, with absolute monarchical power, sat on the right side of the assembly, their version of the house, and the no-good radicals who wanted to try out terrifying and capricious parliamentary monarchy, sat on the left. This is a pretty specific issue to disagree about. So when people, i.e. academics with too much free time, try to come up with meaningful differences between the left and the right that hold true across most of global political history, you get very vague distinctions between the two political families. While today we associate the left and the right mostly with their stances on specific economic issues or cultural debates, the most fundamental distinction that you can probably draw between these two is that the left seeks to change society into something new, and the right seeks to preserve present society or go back to something old.
This is a very biased definition. You can hear it quite clearly as the way he says it, basically saying that the right is composed of nothing but authoritarian powers that seek a hierarchical society with a caste-like system, while the left seeks to strive a utopia where everyone's happy and sucks each other's cocks. He makes this assumption even though some well-known authoritarian powers that strive to a caste-like system are very left-leaning themselves.
In practice, that usually means the left seeks to undermine establish hierarchies and distribute power and wealth more equally, and the right seeks to preserve hierarchy and order since most existing societies are or were built around power being concentrated in very few hands. But obviously, such a simple distinction will certainly make you mad, so be sure to comment why and how I've actually gotten it completely wrong in the comment section. I sure would hate for this video to get more engagement. Anyway, we've lost the plot a little bit here. We're not focusing on either of these groups. We're talking about the illuminated minds who can look past the squabbling of these dirty extremes. Moderates. The people who reject petty ideological battles, and at the end of the day, just know better than you and I.
reject ideological battles? I'll let the audience decide here. Which has more debate? A group of people who make the most logical conclusion in their subjective opinions after looking at all the facts, or a group of people with shared defined values who have all come to accept them as they are all part of that hive mind which has already enshrouded them with said ideology? There is no single definition to being a centrist or a moderate. They have a liberal opinion on one topic, but a conservative opinion on another topic. And there are more ideological battles here as they converse on what is the right path. Are you really going to tell me that this mindset has less debate and dialogue than people who just blindly follow a certain ideology that they have fully accepted as always correct?
Just listen to how terrible the extremes are in this No Labels video on the Biden infrastructure bill.
We've seen this movie before.
Toto!
No, not those movies. This one.
We will not support bipartisan legislation.
I'm telling the Republican senators that we're not going to stand for it.
The extremes on the left and right are trying to defeat a two-party solution for partisan purposes. 3 out of 4 Americans agree on the infrastructure bill that creates jobs, helps families, doesn't raise taxes, and powers America to beat China. Don't listen to the extremes. Support bipartisan infrastructure now.
Cool. Okay, fine. Let's be a little bit more charitable and actually understand what's going on here. Centrists and moderates in the US, the two terms are pretty much interchangeable, are people and politicians who are not entirely satisfied with the political programs of either major political party. Unlike people who reject both parties from the opposite ends of the spectrum, moderates are most at home in the supposed bipartisan middle. They usually like saying things like, "We're neither left nor right." We'll get to that sentence in a minute.
Wow, he gave a vague definition of centrism right there.
But first, we might want to understand centrists a little better. If we are to assume the definition of left and right as historically transcendent terms about the stance one has towards present society and values like egalitarianism, being a centrist doesn't really make sense.
This is not true, as centrism has always existed as an ideology. The late professor of political science at the University of Heidelberg, Klaus Von Beyme, categorized political parties into 7 distinct families from left to right, and most political parties in Western countries are based on the ranks of these sides of the spectrum, and a centrist, which goes right in the middle, exists there too. Many of these political parties have existed for a long time, so it's a little off-putting to say that centrism doesn't make sense.
Over time, movements that start out on the left, like liberalism, republicanism, or even parliamentary monarchy, become solidly right-wing movements without ever changing their ideology because they replace the old right and become contested by the new, more radical left. In such a position, centrism becomes nothing more than a conservative ideology. Its prime directive is resistance to change, and as a result, it's not, as they claim, neither left nor right, it's just right wing. It might have been on the left in yesterday's society, but now that the goals of the old left are the established order and have become the new conservative right, preserving present society with only incremental and moderate reform, which is what centrists believe in, becomes a profoundly conservative worldview. And it makes sense that this is where moderacy settles, because it has to compromise between two completely opposing ideas: changing society in a new way, or keeping it the same.
What he just said here is completely wrong. He is basically saying that only liberals drive society forward and that conservatives are just stubborn old men who aim to keep it that way. He's wrong on so many things here, as first of all, liberalism is mainly about rights of the individual, liberty, consent of the governed, and equality before the law. It is a philosophy mostly centered around the people, and policies are made in that regard. Now, this claim that conservatives never progress society are wrong, as they have always brought forth many polities that have done so. They have come from conservatives all over the world, but let's just focus on the US since Second Thought is talking about America. Examples of Republican policies that have progressed society are the Articles of Confederation, since most of the Founding Fathers were members of the Federalist Party, which was the early version of the Republican Party, the construction of the railway, the gold standard, federalism, the abolition of slavery, the women's rights movement, although that was done together with the Democrats, the 21st Amendment, the Civil Rights Act of 1964, the Voting Rights Act of 1965, just to name a few, were all implemented by Republicans, and repealing any of these would be the thing that regresses society. Second Thought really needs to learn up on his history here.
Think about classic centrist statements like, "We just need a mix of socialism and capitalism." An idea that makes absolutely zero sense when you understand the two ideologies and that their base disagreement about the ownership of the means of production makes them fundamentally incompatible.
Okay, I have to respond to this example because it's not only wrong, but it also contradicts Second Thought's own way of thinking. That is because there is something of a mix between socialism and capitalism. It's called a mixed economic system, where private property is protected and allows a level of economic freedom in the use of capital, but also allows for governments to interfere in economic activities in order to achieve social aims and in other special requirement cases. It is different from free market enterprise, and it is the kind of system that Obama wanted to implement. Perhaps the best known of such systems is the Nordic model that all Western nations, except for the United States, have. What makes Second Thought's claim rather puzzling is that he himself knows this. Finland is not a socialist country. It is a capitalist country that has social programs. How does this guy not know this when he glorifies their system?
Okay, this all might seem a little confusing. Let's get away from the theory for a second and look at something concrete, like the Biden brand of centrism.
I know how to make government work. Not because I talked or tweeted about it, but because I've done it. I've worked across the aisle to reach consensus, to help make government work in the past. I can do that again with your help. Must never be compromised, but compromise itself is not a dirty word. Consensus is not a weakness. It's the only way our founders down the road there thought it was the only way we could govern. It was necessary. It was designed the way the Constitution sits. It requires consensus.
This speech is Biden's freebird. Biden, like pretty much every centrist, is a big fan of compromise. Reaching across the aisle to get past political gridlock is the doctrine of American centrism. And when you hear him talk about it, you can kind of get sucked into the idea that this form of compromise is what makes politics, and therefore society, progress. It appeals to our vision of the democratic ideal, a society in which everyone gathers around the table to discuss an issue and then comes to a mutual decision that compromises on the various interests represented by the assembly. And if, after all, nobody compromises, we might very well not get anywhere.
You don't say, Second Thought. This is how democracy works. Always has, and is done so in all Western countries. Not just among political rivals, but inside political parties themselves.
In American politics, this is anything but democratic, though. And far from leading to the progress we're promised, we get a government that stagnates or actively pursues regressive, reactionary politics. Take immigration.
Really? What is exactly more democratic? Having an effective opposition to ensure freedom of speech and consensus, or a one-party system that always claims to have the correct answers? Because when we look at countries that have such a system, have they really progressed, at least on their own? And to try and prove his point, he talks about immigration for a few minutes, which only solidifies my point. But then he says this.
Malcolm X said it best.
You feel, however, that we're making progress in this country and worldwide?
No. I will never say that progress is being made. If you stick a knife in my back 9 inches and pull it out 6 inches, there's no progress. You pull it all the way out, that's not progress. The progress is healing the wound that the blow made. Won't even admit the knife is there.
You gotta love Second Thought. He's such a defender of democracy and a guardian against fascism when he himself takes advice from, well, the most overrated fascist in history, but still a fascist and a true critic of democracy.
This is American justice.
Yes, sir. That's right.
This is American democracy.
Yes, sir.
And those of you who are familiar with it,
yes,
know that in America, democracy is hypocrisy.
Right.
Now, if I'm wrong, put me in jail.
Right.
But if you can't prove that a democracy is not hypocrisy, then don't put your hands on me.
When reactionary and far-right politics are so dominant in a society as the US, and so regularly find their way to institutions of power, or are baked in right from the start, the centrist stance of compromise and incremental retroactive change allows for politics to jump to the right without ever really coming back. How many politicians today pretend that there's a reasonable compromise between the we need healthcare left and the we need an ethno-state right? Title 42 still stands because the myopic compromise of moderate ideology fails to take into account longer political trends. There are, of course, some exceptions to the rightward shift of American politics, but the attachment to moderation at all costs makes any left-wing legislation a blip in what is otherwise a sea of reactionary bravado.
I think it's quite clear to see that Second Thought has an us-versus-them mentality. He is so invested in his own views that he believes that anyone who disagrees is just an extremist from the other side of the spectrum. He just sounds like a well-spoken social justice warrior here.
But most centrists don't like this, and that's not how they think about themselves. They don't like the idea that they're just a mushy average of the left and the right, or a simple tool of conservative politics. Instead, moderates describe their stance something like this. I don't care whether something comes from the left or the right. I just look at the idea and judge it on its own merit. Here, the tricky centrist thinks he's gotten us. We couldn't possibly disagree with the idea of sensibly considering multiple options and forming an opinion based on rational cost and benefit analyses. And he's right, but at the end of the day, centrism falls right back into the same place whether it sees its role as averaging out the left and the right, or picking and choosing from each side. And that's because the Overton window is so small and so skewed in the US. The choices centrists make are limited by the acceptable politics they are contextualized in, and the American political spectrum being so stunted toward the right with only figures like Bernie Sanders and his social democratic politics even approaching the left means that centrism will by default fall into the conservative, stagnatory, or even regressive role. There just aren't that many options to choose from, and they're mostly on the same side anyway. Even if the centrist voter is a careful and considerate pragmatist who doesn't blindly follow the party line and thinks entirely for themselves on every topic and political debate, the inevitable fact that they will be picking and choosing policies from the fascistic Trumpism in the Republican Party and the neoliberal capitalism of the Democrats, to the extent that they can even be differentiated at times, means they'll never actually consider the full range of political debate because the left isn't prominently represented. The result is the center conserves far more than it progresses. And when it chooses to conserve something built by the right, it actively engages in regressive, reactionary politics.
And this is the catalyst that I have been talking about regarding this guy. He basically just admitted right now that only the left is right. Second Thought is making a very dangerous statement by saying that the left is always right. Do you know what kind of people say those statements about their ideologies? Brainwashed people. This guy is no different than the neocon retards at Prager University who claim that conservatism is always right. Please tell me you see a correlation here.
Why are you right? Yes, you, conservative person. It is a more practical, generous, and compassionate way to live. The right tends to be risk-averse, more concerned about external threats, like tyranny and terror. Conservatives, get this, tend to be conservative. They are less likely to play with fire in just about every sense. Financially, artistically, sexually, they are cautious about changing traditions, sometimes to a fault, which is why they cling to that crazy constitution they like so much and to their guns and their religion. We conservatives also focus on what we can fix and accept what we cannot. Liberals, the research tells us, are generally more outgoing, more likely to try new stuff. They're open to new ideas, though not school choice or flat taxes or a market-based healthcare reform, and are less likely to feel threatened by unfamiliar things. In short, liberals are pretty liberal. They feel free to take risks that the risk-averse usually end up paying for over and over. Which explains the necessity for conservatism. We are the cleanup crew. Liberals may seem to have more fun, and many do, but according to polls, they aren't as happy as conservatives. And with all the fun they're having, I've never quite figured out why the angriest people I've encountered in my life have been liberals. Conservatism makes what liberalism takes. In short, conservatism doesn't compete with liberalism. It sustains it. Without conservatism, there is no liberalism.
There's also the issue that politicians who call themselves the center aren't really doing so in good faith. While they may represent the center between elected officials, the actual center of the American people is far more to the left on many key issues than the center of the American political class.
Really? Are you sure that the population is relatively on the left? Because a 2021 Pew Research study found that most people in American society are somewhere in the middle. This is also similar in other developed nations.
I've studied human behavior long enough to get sick of it. You gotta remember, most folks are still neighborly. Ned Flanders, unfuckably nice. But right now, the edges are rougher than ever. On the right, you got shit-nosed extremists wondering aloud whether Hitler was all bad and inventing their own clown house reality. And on the left, you got fucking whiny woke lords canceling the shit out of anyone who dares to take a dump at the wrong time of the day. And both sides look so unhappy it makes you want to puke.
MLK made it very clear. The moderate's role in politics is to slow things down to a trickle. Justice gets delayed further and further, never actually realized despite decades of promises, allowing for millions of people to continue suffering injustice and hundreds of thousands more to be brought into the fold. It's trite, but justice delayed is justice denied. The issue we're going to have to figure out is how we do anything about this. In every election, moderates are going to dominate the field because they will continuously be presented as more sensible, measured, and pragmatic than their opponents. They have done the careful electoral calculation and know that between the people who will inevitably vote for them and the people who will never vote for them regardless of what they do, the only way to win is to present themselves to the colossal group of American moderates who won't bother to go any further than see who gets closest to being the exact average of the Democrats and the Republicans. We know Americans want more from their politicians. We know that, for the greatest number of them, those things are further to the left than anything the government has provided in decades. That is a much bigger issue for our democracy than polarization. Democracy is slow by nature, and there are times when that can be a good thing. But when democracy is slowed down artificially like this, just for the sake of slowing it down and not letting things change for the better, when politicians ignore what people not only demand, but desperately need, it no longer resembles democracy nor its ideals. If you're hearing an appeal to authoritarianism or something in these statements, you're not understanding what I'm saying. We need far greater democracy than what we have today. Real democracy. Democracy for the majority. And continuing to venerate moderates in this country won't bring us any closer to getting it.
If I could say anything to Second Thought, it's that this is an appeal to authoritarianism, because he is basically saying that the left is the only rational way forward and its policy must be forced onto people whether they agree with it or not. Left-leaning communist dictators in the 20th century have tried this. Has it really progressed their societies? You're going to have a very hard time arguing that this is the case. Real democracy, as how Second Thought tries to explain it, cannot function with a one-party system because it hinders the people's ability to choose and, more importantly, remove their governments if its party's policies do not serve their interests. Moderacy is what has progressed us and has brought us to the society we have today. It is the reason why you have a warm home with food on the table, and why you have nice stuff, and more importantly, why you're able to talk about this on the internet. Today our society, not only in the US, but in the Western world in general, is so divided that people ask whether you're a liberal or a conservative and reject the elected candidate on the other side, essentially rejecting democracy. In previous years, no one said, "Not my president." It was only a question of whether or not you were American or not. In the past, Republicans advocated for universal health care in the U.S.
It was in my State of the Union address that I said, "Let us remove a financial specter facing our older Americans, the fear of an illness so expensive that it can result in having to make an intolerable choice between bankruptcy and death."
Democrats also advocated for regulations that would stop illegal immigration, including putting landmines on the border.
Yes, in the last 3 weeks, it has become an emergency for us. Well, there's an awful lot of illegals coming in. By the hundred, by the thousands, our people are not only in some of the crews where there's now strike breaking, some of those crews are 100% illegals. Outright, openly, with no attempt to disguise it. It's a vicious attack on the local worker, and it's just one of those things that agribusiness thinks they can get away with it, and our job is to inform the whole country what's happening together with a boycott and solve it that way.
This is the people that have given us everything that we have today, something that our ancestors could only have dreamed of having. Extremism on any side of the spectrum is never the answer. Now, I am more of a cat person, but I would like to have a Cocker Spaniel one day. Naturally, I would have to train it, the same way I just schooled second thought on something as basic as politics.